Do you remember the time when nullable reference types were added to C-sharp? It was C-sharp 8, like a century ago or something like that. Not surprisingly, in the deep shadow of such a big feature as nullable reference types, we also got property patterns. A much smaller feature, but with the potential to make big changes in the way how we write C-sharp code. It got many smaller updates later in the later years, and now we have quite a powerful set of property patterns we can use. And in this video, I will show you some of them. So please join me in the demo, where I will first show you the bare syntax, and then we will move to a more complicated examples. The first example will be just a simple method that transforms a string value so that it fits in a field of width 20. Traditionally, we might check the length of the string, otherwise we get to the default case. This is traditional C-sharp. Property patterns came with the is operator, and they let you match an object against a set of property boolean conditions, such as whether the length is less or equal to 20. This is really not the use case for property patterns. I mean, why change the previous code, which was just checking the length of the string? Property patterns are coming with switch expressions, which also came in the same release of C#. Switch expression lets you write a case like this one, an object with length smaller or equal to 20. Otherwise, the default case is to take the first 17 characters, append the ellipsis, and return that. Now our code is becoming declarative. We just say what should happen in which of the cases. And it is the compiler's job to make that happen. The compiler will transform this switch expression into a sequence of if statements. But that's not our job anymore. Let me show you a more complicated example in the same domain, a method that also fits a string value into a field. This time, taking care of the alignment and the dynamically specified field size. My plan is to match the properties of two objects at the same time, and we can do that too. Actually, you can switch over anything. It is useful but not mandatory to switch over the objects that implement equality members, but again, not mandatory. You can put any objects here. I am capturing the length of the string, but not testing it yet. I'm just capturing it in a variable named len. Then I'm also assuring that the alignment is negative, that is, left aligned. And then comes the when expression. I'm checking whether the length of the string is not larger than the width. A similar expression with align right. The third variant would capture the length and do the check again, but it would ignore the alignment because after checking for less than zero, greater than zero, then it must be zero. So I'm ignoring that parameter with a discard. And you see, these three lines of code are substituting a sequence of three if-else ifs that would do the same thing in an imperative piece of code. Let's keep going. We are not interested in the length anymore. I'm discarding the first parameter because we know that the length is greater than width. Now, we have exhausted all cases where length was not greater than width. Six lines of code for six substantially different outputs. If I wanted to use if else, it would be two or three times larger code, mostly consisting of curly braces. You don't need any of those anymore. This is very compact, very readable. You can see all the possibilities with one glance and understand exactly what this expression, this entire expression is doing. I will now show you how this works on several strings of varying lengths. I will apply all three alignments to each of the strings. Here you can see that all the strings were formatted and aligned precisely inside the allowed screen size. My expression is working well, exactly as I wanted it to do, but there is more behind the scenes. Watch this. If I introduced a pattern before any other, I would immediately get a compile time error, because this branch is shadowing. It is more general than the subsequent branch. The compiler detects that and reports a compile time error. In the future, I expect that C# will also support dynamic patterns like this one. It would help us avoid the when clause. I hope we'll see patterns like this in the future. C# is not supporting them right now, unfortunately. But then, it's just the syntax. Let me show you how that works on a more complicated example. The request is to implement control of the HVAC system. It has the operating mode set centrally for the entire building, the air circulation setting, the year season, and the current operating state. There are also the temperature and humidity sensors. The temperature will require comparison in the patterns I am about to write, so I will implement that too. There will also be the way to query the ideal temperature range which HVAC system should maintain in the room, and we are ready to begin implementing the control system. The task is, given the state of the device and the state of the sensors, to calculate the subsequent state of the device. Can you write a method of this kind? Do you know how many branching there will be, depending on all the state of the device and the sensor input? It would be a dozen or two dozen ifs. Do you want to write them? I have a much more compact implementation in mind, which I am about to show you. But before that, let me remind you that this channel and all the videos on this channel are free for everybody, but only thanks to the patrons who are supporting this channel. So if you like what you're learning from my videos, then please consider joining the growing community of patrons on my Patreon page. Thank you. Let's move on to implementing this method now. The change will primarily depend on the device, and I will check its properties. If the state of the device is off, then it will remain off. I will change nothing. However, anything beyond this point means that the state of the device is not off. It is in some operative state, and now we check the other properties. If the mode, which is set for the entire building, is off, and this device is not off, then I will move it to standby so that you can listen to further instructions. If the season is heating, then I will introduce another method to regulate heating. If the season is cooling, I will do it in a different method that regulates cooling. And otherwise, if none of these patterns has been matched, I will just leave the device in the state in which it is currently. So I move my attention to the smaller methods. Irrespective of the device state, if the temperature is below the lowest allowed temperature, then the device should be heating the room. If the device is heating already and the air circulation is set to inject the external air and the temperature is above the high threshold, then stop heating and switch to ventilating. Otherwise, everything is the same, but the air exchange property is missing, because it means that we are circulating the inside air. In that case, I want to turn the device to standby. The rules are as you see on the screen now. Otherwise, just don't do anything. Similar set of patterns will follow for the cooling mode. It all doesn't matter. You have seen the principle. I have made the whole series of property patterns that are capturing every imaginable state of the device and the sensors. And with that, I have prepared a simulation of some random states. I will print them out. I will run the application and check whether my system is behaving as it should. If there's anything wrong with this logic, then I can just recognize the branch which is covering the transition where I'm not calculating the result correctly. This code is very easy to understand, and it is entirely based on property patterns. So I hope that this video has helped you see the bigger picture behind property patterns and how they can be used to organize code, to organize branching logic when there is a lot of branching to do.